I almost feel like it's too easy to introduce our next speaker. You know, you got a famous last name. You make a joke about being a saint. You know, our diocese was so proud of St. Mary Ann Cope. There were signs all over that said, we have a saint. I was going to say, we have a saint, but he's still in the making. So I don't want to go too far with that. But I thought about another connection. In 2009, when Syracuse football needed guidance and direction, they reached out to New Orleans for a saint. And we got Doug Marone. And I know Coach Lombardi was working with him a little bit along the way. He's worked with some of our graduates as well along the way. And I'm pretty excited because I think Syracuse made the right reach this year. We reached out to a coach who's really going to bring it. And I think we're going to benefit just as much from this saint in the making. Let's welcome Joe Lombardi to the stage.
Thank you. It's good to be here. Living down in New Orleans now, and spent most of my life up north. In fact, I lived in Erie, Pennsylvania for 4 years, and walking out this morning into the snow reminded me that there's some really great things about living down south. But I first just want to say thank you for inviting me to be here today. I know that this day, meeting a lot of you men, seeing your enthusiasm for being out here, listening to the other speakers, meeting some of the men and the priests that have organized this event. It's going to be a great source of encouragement and motivation for me personally as I leave here today to go out and live my Catholic faith. And hopefully you're feeling the same thing. I think it's important that we don't underestimate how important that motivation is. It's one of our biggest challenges as football coaches. You know, we start training camp in late July. And leading up to training camp, we give the players a good 5-6 weeks off, and as coaches, we take the same time off. So it gives us a chance to reconnect with our family and get rested. So when we get ready for training camp in July, late July, everyone's rested and they're ready to go. Players are feeling fresh, their legs are strong, nobody's got any injuries to deal with. As coaches, we're rested. And so those first few days of training camp, those first few practices are sharp. Everyone's full of enthusiasm, they're running around fast, there's a lot of excitement. And then pretty soon, training camp can start wearing on guys, all right? You start getting, legs are tired. Guys starting getting nicked up a little bit. They've got sprains and strains and bruises. And as coaches, we're not getting as much sleep probably as we should, and so we can get a little grumpy. And so right away, as coaches, we start working on motivation. You know, within a few days in a camp, we're gonna start bringing in guest speakers to talk to the players. All right, we'll bring in John Gruden or Dick Vermeil, someone that they're not used to listening to every day, to try to reach in and keep that enthusiasm level high. We'll cut out motivational movie clips and show the players, just try to keep that excitement level. We'll have our video staff make highlight films from the year before and put it to a nice soundtrack, all right, and show that to the players so that they keep rekindling that excitement and that enthusiasm so every day when we go out to work, we're getting their best effort. And that, let me tell you, that's the best one. I don't envy these players' fame. I don't envy their money, and I wouldn't mind it, but I don't envy it. But I do envy having slow motion highlights with a kick butt soundtrack behind it, okay? That is cool. I gotta admit, I'm envious of that. But the point is, we're trying to keep these guys enthused and keep that energy level high. And I think it's important that we remind ourselves that it's important for us in our own life. So we're all gonna leave here, and hopefully we're all gonna be enthused, and we're all gonna be encouraged and fired up to go out and do a better job living our Catholic faith. But then we gotta go face the world, all right? And we're gonna see discouragement, okay? There's gonna be temptations, there's gonna be frustrations, and we're gonna be dealing with our own figurative tired legs and bumps and bruises and sprains. And so I think it's important that we take the initiative to keep motivating ourselves every day by the people that you surround yourselves with. Pay attention to what you're reading, what you're watching, what you're listening. Okay, is it pulling you in the direction you want to go, or is it kind of pulling you the direction the world will pull you? Because if we don't take the initiative and we leave it up just to what we meet as we go into the everyday world, it's going to be tough. You know, I hope it's not sacrilegious to suggest that maybe the devil's got a better marketing department down there than they got in heaven. So I think it's important that we search out those motivational sources so we can keep on track. Because there's going to be discouragements. You know, I remember we've got 6 kids now, my wife and I. And a few years back, we're getting ready to have our 5th kid. We find out it's going to be a boy. And so we're sitting around talking about names. And we just recently got a dog, so I've got two daughters. At the time, they were 5 and 3. And they're giving out suggestions that are better suited for dogs. So our hearing, hey, we could name him Sarge, or we could name him Duke. How about Chief? All right. So my wife explains to him, she says, hey, listen, those are great ideas. But when we have a baby, we've got to give him a saint's name. All right, so we've got to come up with the name of a saint. And so there's a pause, and my son Joseph looks at me, up at me, and he says, like Reggie Bush? That's a true story. And so my wife and I, we're really trying to raise our kids in a rich Catholic environment. We've got crucifixes up in every room, and we've got religious art, and we try to say a family rosary every day, and my wife takes the older kids to adoration, and we say we have to come up with a saint's name, and that's what we get. So it was understandable, but it was still discouraging. But I think the point is, as we leave here, just remember to feed your spiritual side, okay? Because your spirit's going to eat, and if you don't choose what it feeds on, it's going to end up feeding on garbage. You know, whenever I'm asked to give a speech, I think of my grandfather, Vince Lombardi, who, by all accounts, was pretty good at talking to groups. A lot of people don't know that my grandfather started off in high school in the seminary. He spent 3 years in the seminary in high school discerning whether he wanted to be a priest or not, or whether he was called to be a priest. And he ultimately decided against it, but his faith remained of primary importance in his life. He went to Mass every single day, in season and out of season. And Bart Starr would tell you, his quarterback in Green Bay, if you listened to Vince Lombardi at practice in the afternoon, you understood why he had to go to Mass every morning. Okay? But to the extent that he could control his temper, to the extent that he could control his volatile nature, he said that it was all due to the strength that he got from receiving communion every day. So his faith was very important to him. It was the most important thing. In fact, people sometimes ask me, you know, my grandpa's famous for a lot of quotes. I'm sure you've seen him up. He gets quoted a lot. And people ask me, what's your favorite quote? And I think back to when he stood in front of his team, and he said, you need three priorities in your life, okay? Only three: your faith, your family, and the Green Bay Packers. Now, that's always been a good anchor point for me, okay? Now, right now, I'm substituting the New Orleans Saints for the Green Bay Packers, but you get the point: your faith, your family, and then whatever's third, you know, your livelihood, what have you. And so it's always been a good anchor point for me, a good chance for me to kind of calibrate my life by. Unfortunately, if you look at me, especially during the season, too often it's going to appear that I've got those priorities mixed up in reverse order, all right? So it's always good for me to sit back and look, hey, am I living my life according to these values, these priorities? And my job during the season is very time consuming. It's very demanding. And so out of the season, I've got to look and say, hey, as much as I'd like to go golf with the guys, because I'm away from my family so much, I'm not going to do that, all right? I'm not going to hunt. I'm not going to fish. So a lot of these hobbies that maybe if I had a normal 9-to-5 job, I'd partake in, I've just put those all away. And so it's helped me to prioritize my life. Some of my grandfather's speeches have been caught on audio, and I've listened to them. And one speech in particular, he started out talking about all the different issues that he thought he might talk about. And it was the late 60s. There was a lot of social upheaval. So there was a lot of things that he probably could have spoken on. But he said he came to the conclusion that the only thing he was really qualified to speak on was football. And in reality, I'm probably in the same situation. And so what I want to do is I'm going to talk to you about what we're looking for in a football player. And then I'm going to try to apply that to how that can help us be better Catholics. Because I remember one time in an interview, someone asked me, how does being a Catholic help you be a better football coach? And I'll be honest, I really didn't have a great answer for him. And I'm not sure I do have one today. But I think the better question is, how does being a football coach help me be a better Catholic? So that's what I'm going to talk about. And so right now, in our schedule as football coaches, what we're doing is we're watching a lot of tape on potential draft picks. And so I'm going to talk about what I'm looking for in a quarterback. In fact, I spent all Thursday looking at Ryan Nassib up here at Syracuse. I think he's going to be a successful NFL quarterback. But he reminds me a lot of Drew Brees, actually. But I'm going to talk about what I'm looking for in a quarterback and then try to relate that to how we can live our Catholic faith better. So the first thing I want to know about a guy, all right, if we're going to bring him onto our team, is I want to know if he's coachable. Okay, is he going to listen to coaching? Now, if a guy makes it to the NFL, especially as a quarterback, probably means he's pretty talented, probably means he's had a lot of success. The best quarterbacks are notorious control freaks. And so these guys have a very strong vision of how they think things should go. And they're not afraid to tell you. Now, if you've got a very smart guy like Drew Brees, you're pretty smart to listen to him, right? He's got opinions, they're usually pretty good ones, and we usually go with them. But every now and then, he might have a play. And you got to say, well, Drew, I like the play, but I don't think we can hold up in protection. Or we'd rather go with this play because we think it's got better answers against such and such a coverage. You know, he sometimes is asking, hey, why are we playing this guy and not that guy? Well, it's special teams, you know. So you got to negotiate with him a little bit. Now, Drew is great. You know, after we have these discussions, whatever we decide as coaches, he's on board. So when we get to Sunday, he believes 100% in our plan, and we're charging full speed ahead. Everyone's on the same page. Gives us a great chance to win. Not every player is like that. Some guys, their pride gets involved. And so you might hear them in the locker room, not on our team, thank God, but I know it happens. Can't believe this game plan's garbage. It's not going to work. You know, what are we doing with this play? That thing's a surefire interception. I don't know why we're playing this guy. This other guy's so much better. So they start to complain. All right, they're not bought in. They're not on the same page. It's not going to give us a great chance to win. And quite frankly, he's not going to play as well as he should. And I think that this is a good lesson for us in our faith. I think it's important that we're coachable. You know, the bishop this morning at Mass, he talked about when the Pope was being elected and there was all this, the newspapers, oh, is the church going to change their teachings on this? So they go, of course not. All right, the church has been consistent for 2,000 years on those core values of, you know, the faith and morals that we believe in. They're not going to change. And so it's hard for me to understand when I'm talking to someone, they say, well, I'm Catholic, but I don't really agree with the church's teaching on, you know, artificial contraception or abortion, or I don't see why I have to go to a priest to confess my sins. All right, it makes no sense to me. I get that you might have trouble with the teaching. I get that you might not totally understand it, all right? But you can't say you don't agree with it, because we've got a name for people like that. It's called being a Protestant, all right? If you're Catholic, and hey, there are a lot of Protestants that I deeply admire and love, so I didn't mean that as an insult, but you get the point. As a Catholic, we've got a game plan, all right? We've got a head coach. This thing has been in place for 2,000 years, all right? Let's just get on board and go with it. And I think you'll, and listen, I know it's not easy, all right? I got six kids. I know it's not always easy to follow what the Catholic Church tells us. And when I have to wake up early tomorrow and round these kids up and get them off the church and hope that they don't misbehave too much, it's going to be, you know, like I said, it's not easy, but it's better for us. I wouldn't trade what I have with my family for anything, okay? Now, it's not necessarily, we can't promise you that it's always going to turn out for the best on this world, right? This isn't a self-help program. Some people, when they follow Christ faithfully, they end up upside down on a cross, right? But I think it's our job to be coachable and follow what the church says. And it was, I think, St. Augustine who said, he was talking about the Gospels, he said, if you believe what you like in the Gospels and reject what you don't like, it's not the Gospels you believe in, but yourself. And so I think it's important for us to be coachable. The second thing I want to talk about, all right, when I'm looking at a player, I want to know about, does he love football? All right, because if you love the game, you're going to be committed, you're going to work hard. And it may surprise you how hard it is to prepare yourself to be a quarterback in the NFL. Steve Young was a Hall of Fame quarterback for the San Francisco 49ers, and he was also a law school graduate. And he said that the preparation, the memorization, the amount of study it took him to get ready for a football game on Sunday was far greater than what it took him to get through law school. All right, so let me just go through a little bit the quarterback schedule. All right, so we play a game on Sunday. Quarterback shows up on Monday, all right, they're going to get a lift, they're going to run, they're going to watch the game from the day before, kind of look at what we did good, what we did bad, try to correct the mistakes, and then they're going to crack the lid on our next opponent. They're going to start watching some film of who we're playing the next Sunday. Tuesday's a player's day off, but quarterbacks are always in. Okay, they're going to watch at least four game films of our next opponent. They're going to watch the blitz cut-ups. They're going to watch the formational tapes. Okay, so they're going to be watching film all day Tuesday. They'll go home, and as coaches Tuesday night, we're going to finalize the first and second down game plan. and we're going to get it to them Tuesday night. So by the time that they come in on Wednesday, we've expected that they've read it over, studied a little bit, have a good feel for what's in there. Anything they didn't understand, have your questions ready. So Wednesday, we're going to install that game plan. We're going to go out and practice it. Eat lunch after lunch. We're going to watch the practice film. And really, the quarterbacks will stay after and watch a little more film, but by the time they leave the facility on Wednesday, we expect them to effectively have that first and second down game plan memorized. So when they hear, all right, guys, we're running fix right, flash 40, F bubble, kill 382 deli, I want them to know, all right, first they got to repeat that right back, all right, they've got to have it memorized. They got to know that we're running the 40 for shell. Unless we get the nickel walk, then we're going to make a Mickey left call, we're going to throw the bubble. They start bringing seven in the box. If this slot's uncovered, I'm going to make the Mickey call and throw the bubble. But if it's press, kill, 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 we're running 382 deli. And don't forget, if we get a bare front, Packer left, okay? So that's one play. One play in the game plan, all right? They also have to have it memorized. And I know last week we were running Y2, green right nasty, fake slash 37, buster solid, naked right, Z-sting, X-spear. This week it's green right stack, Z-mo. All right, so have that memorized. And what's the three ways we're running ride 35 Bob this week? So there is a lot of study, a lot of work that goes in it. And then guess what? Wednesday night, as coaches, we finish the third down game plan. We get it off to them. Same thing happens on Thursday. All right, so by the time they leave the facility on Thursday, okay, what are the eight plays we're running on third and 2 to 3? What coverage are we expecting to see? Third and 4 to 6, et cetera, et cetera. All right, so they do that all day Thursday. Thursday night, we're going to finalize red zone, short yardage, goal line, get it out to them, and by the time Friday's done, they should have all that memorized. And so by the time Friday comes along, I know I'm worn out, all right, and I can't wait till practice is over because there's no more game planning to do. So I'm going to grab lunch, tie up whatever loose ends I have to do, and I am home. Going to go home and see my family probably for the first time all week. Players are worn out. They've had 3 hard practices. They're getting out of there. So everyone is scattering like rats when the lights come on, all right? We're getting home, getting somewhere to recharge our batteries for the game on Sunday. Well, there's been a couple times where I've had some family or friends out of town. I'm kind of showing them around the facility. It's pretty empty. Everyone's gone. And you walk into a meeting room, and there's Drew Brees huddled over his game plan, studying it over and over again. Make sure he knows everything about it, front and back. Okay, you might catch him standing up, taking a slow motion drop, visualizing the routes as they're unfolding, visualizing the coverage so that he's got a plan for no matter what happens, every contingency. The guy is committed. He loves the game. Now, most people hear this, and they say, well, sure, he's a quarterback in the NFL. If you play that position well, you're going to make millions of dollars. You're going to have all kinds of endorsement opportunities, 70,000 people screaming your name every Sunday, millions of people cheering you on TV. It wouldn't be that hard with those kind of incentives, with those kind of payoffs, to work that hard, right? We'd probably all agree with that. But you would be surprised. You talk to coaches around the league, and you'll hear them complain, our guy doesn't work hard enough. He doesn't study the game plan hard enough. We can't do protections like you do because our quarterback's not going to figure out the blitzes like your guy does. And so you hear coaches struggling with guys that aren't putting in the work, all right? And it may be surprising. But then we can turn the focus on us, all right? How committed are we to our faith? How hard do we work on it, okay? Now, just like we say, well, if I had a chance to be quarterback, I'd work hard. Sometimes I think we can fall in that trap, you know? I used to think, well, if I could just go back to Jesus' time, if I could just really see him and hear him talk and you know, have a chance to touch the hem of his garment, what a good Catholic I'd be, you know, what a good Christian I'd be, how I'd sacrifice for him. And the truth is, you know, I've got about 10 versions of the Bible on this phone right here, you know, and I can look up any subject I want, get on the internet, tell me everything the Bible says about marriage. Boom, there it is. We've got more access and a better opportunity to hear Jesus' words today than we've ever had in the history of mankind, all right? I've got 2 adoration chapels within easy driving distance of my house. I should be there more. We've got great opportunity to be in his presence. And so I think that's kind of an excuse. And you might say, well, listen, yeah, I mean, I get that, but what if I could really hear it in his own voice? What if I could really, you know, see him in the form that we see each other with 2 arms and 2 legs? And I think, well, what would make us different than the people who were back there then? You know, his 12 hand-picked disciples, one betrayed him, one denied him, they all abandoned him, right? And we think, oh, we would have been so much better. Probably not. You know, I think of the story of the lady who was hemorrhaging, and so the miracle happened when she touched his cloak, and he felt the power rush out of him. I hope we all remember this story. And he turned around and said, "Who touched me?" And if you remember, his disciples were like, "What do you mean, who touched you? We're in this huge crowd. Everyone's bumping against you. Everyone was touching you." And so sometimes I know that I'm one of these people that show up, you know, and you know this happened. People showed up, listened to him, and they said, "I don't see what the big deal is." They walked away. They didn't get it. People touched him. They didn't feel his power because their faith was lacking. Okay, so I think it's an excuse for us to say, "Hey, we would be better if." Okay, we've got all those opportunities now. There's no excuse. All right, we need to be the hardest working Catholics, just like we want our quarterback to be the hardest working. And you think of the payoff, right? I'd work hard as being a quarterback because there'd be millions of dollars and lots of fans. We're talking about a payoff that dwarfs that, aren't we? And so keep that in mind. And, you know, I'm always reminded of a C.S. Lewis quote. He said, "Either Christianity is false and of no importance, or it's true and of infinite importance. The only thing it can't be is of moderate importance." And too often I know, if you looked at me day to day, you'd say, "Well, he's kind of treating it as if it's moderately important." And so there's a challenge. Let's make sure that we're committed to this faith and witnessing that it is of infinite importance. So we talked about being coachable. We talked about being committed. Next thing I want to know about a quarterback is, he tough? Right? First, there's physical toughness, right? These guys take hits and they got to get back up. But more importantly is mental toughness. I don't care how good a quarterback you are going to deal with adversity in this game. You're going to have a bad pass. You're going to have a bad series. You might have a bad game. Even the great ones sometimes have subpar seasons. So the question is, when you face that adversity, how do you bounce back? I think that we've probably got one of the most mentally tough quarterbacks in the NFL in Drew Brees. When he has a bad game, and they happen, you get on the bus after the game, and he says, "I feel sorry for these poor guys we play next week. We are going to rip them." I mean, he just can't wait to get back after it. He never loses any confidence. We make mistakes, we learn from them, and then we move on with 100% confidence, all right? That's kind of our motto. There's other quarterbacks that just can't let it go. A bad pass, an interception, they can't forgive themselves. You know, you see them on the sidelines, and their body language, their heads are drooping, their shoulders are drooping. That's something that we would never tolerate, all right, as a team. Body language, we're always preaching it. All right, so if you can't let go of that last play, right, one bad play turns into two bad plays, turns into a bad series, turns into a bad game, turns into a bad season, two bad seasons, pretty soon you're no longer a quarterback in the NFL. So we're always trying to teach that mental toughness, learn from it, and then put it away. Now, this is big for me personally, because I can tend to be a little bit of a perfectionist. And so I will get enthusiastic about something. Hey, this is gonna be my new prayer commitments. I'm gonna say prayers in the morning. I'm gonna say the rosary every day. I'm gonna make it to adoration once a week. I'm gonna have my night prayers. This is gonna go great. And it's going great for a while. And then I get to lunch, and man, I never got to my morning prayers. I didn't make it to adoration this week. And you can get discouraged. You know, you kind of start beating yourself up a little bit, and that energy level goes down, and pretty soon, just like one bad play can lead to two bad plays, missing your morning prayers can mean missing your evening prayers. Or let's say you're fighting with some sort of, you know, a sin of yours or a weakness, you know, your temper. Being more patient with my kids, right? I'm going to do great at this, and then kids piss me off and I explode, and now I'm discouraged again. And so I think it's important that we learn to pick ourselves up after getting sacked. We pick ourselves up after a bad pass, and we get going again with that same enthusiasm, all right? I hear a lot about Catholic guilt, you know, like it's a bad thing. I think guilt's a good thing. When we do something wrong, we should feel guilty. But you can't let that guilt hold you back. You can't let one sin turn into two sins, okay? So we acknowledge when we do something wrong. We confess it, hopefully sacramentally. And then we get on with our lives, resolved to sin no more and to avoid the near occasion of sin. And so this is important. You know, John Paul II said that Christian holiness does not mean being sinless, but rather it means struggling not to give in and always getting up after every fall. So it's very important for us to not forget that. Don't get discouraged, all right? We're all gonna fall, we're all gonna fail, we're all sinners, but we can't let it get us down, we can't let it take away our enthusiasm for being the people we wanna be. All right, so we talked about that we're coachable, we're committed, and we're mentally tough. Next thing I wanna know about a guy is I'm gonna look at his fundamentals. How does he throw the football? I want to look at his footwork. And more importantly, how committed is he to keeping these fundamentals sound? So we're in the NFL now, right? I'm coaching the NFL, and I've got Drew Brees, who's going to go into his 13th year in the NFL. He's got all kinds of records. He's going to be a surefire Hall of Famer. In every practice, we start out with 10 minutes of what we call on the line. And what on the line is, it's center and quarterbacks. We call a play, Drew repeats it, calls his cadence, takes a snap, and goes through the initial footwork of whatever play we just called. 10 minutes, really, we're just practicing center quarterback exchange. It's probably the first thing Drew Brees learned when he started playing quarterback in junior high, all right? And it would be very easy for him to come out and be like, hey, listen, man, I'm the man, I'm a Pro Bowler, got 13 years in, I got all kinds of records, all right? I'll do this, but it's not gonna be real serious, okay? I got this center quarterback exchange thing down, all right, coach? Let's get to something real. But he doesn't. He knows how important it is, so his chin strap's always buckled and he's always focused and he's working it, making sure that these little things never get out of reach or never get out of whack, working the fundamentals constantly. There's another good quarterback in the NFL named Tom Brady, all right? He plays up in New England. You may have heard of him. So Tom Brady, early on in his, I think when he was in junior high, he met up with a coach who kind of taught him how to throw. He grooved in his fundamentals. And so Tom Brady always kept in touch with this guy. Unfortunately, this coach just died last year. But up until that point, Tom would be playing in the season, and he'd be playing pretty well, but there would be something. He's like, this ain't quite right. I'm not playing as well as I think I should. I'm missing a pass here. I'm missing a pass there. I need to get back to my fundamentals. And so he would fly this coach in during the season, and they would have a couple fundamental sessions. All right, hey, you got to shorten up your stride. Tuck that elbow in, all right? We need a little more torque in this pass. And so he would go through a fundamental session during the season so he could get back to play the way that he knew he needed to play, all right? So it was all about fundamentals. And so I think it's important for us to reflect on what are the fundamentals of our faith, all right? Number one, they're the sacraments, right? They're the Eucharist, they're confession, they're prayer, all right? Say the rosary. Right. Find an adoration chapel if you can and try to get an hour in every week of adoration. You know, in the Bible, Jesus says, when you pray, pray like this. When you fast, fast like this. When you give, give like this. He didn't say if, all right? You're kind of expected to do that. So prayer, fasting, almsgiving. These are the fundamentals. And I know that in my own life, when all of a sudden I'm starting to, you know, have a little turbulence going on, you know, I'm not, as Tom Brady would say, I'm not playing exactly as well as I think I should. You know, I'm having some turbulence in relationships or inner conflict. I know that usually I look and I say, you know what? I've kind of gotten out of whack with my fundamentals. I'm not praying like I should. I've missed adoration. It's been too long since I've been to confession. And once I get back on track and I start executing those fundamentals more consistently, it seems like things smooth out. My problems don't go away, but I'm just able to deal with them better. And I think it's important that if you do get into this and you're being disciplined, sometimes you can kind of get proud of yourself. And we have to understand that these things are just putting us, it's not about us, it's not about the discipline of our prayer, it's about putting ourselves where the Holy Spirit can act on us, okay? And I just want to make this clear. There's, you know, I know a lot of people that I really respect for their spirituality, you know, and they, well, the Holy Spirit told me to do this and God moved me to do that. And if you're like me, that doesn't really, you don't ever have those knockout moments, you know? I never really feel the hand of God telling me what to do. Don't be discouraged. You know, he's working in all of our lives. Some people get that consolation where they really feel the Holy Spirit moving them. Some of us, like me, just kind of go along and things end up working out usually, and you can see the Holy Spirit only when you're looking back. So be committed to your fundamentals. And, you know, our spiritual lives, think about like you have spiritual muscles, right? We all have bodily muscles. And we know that if we lay in bed for a year, for a month and watch TV, that we're going to get weak. You know, our muscles are going to get weak. We're going to get weaker. And so think of your spiritual life. Think of it like spiritual muscles. We have to exercise them. That's what the prayer and the sacraments, that's what they do. They're exercising. It's making our spiritual muscles stronger. So it's important. And I know I can get, as a coach in the NFL, I can get caught up in what we call scheme. You know, a lot of people study the Saints offense because it's, you know, people think that we do as good a job as anyone of coming up with good plays and attacking defenses. And so you can kind of get caught up in that. Hey, man, we're going to come up with something really, hey, look at this play we designed, look at this formation, but it's blocking and tackling that wins in the NFL, so it's important not to lose track of that. And so I know in my own life sometimes, you know, I'll buy books and read about religion and read about the faith, and that's important, and I think we know that we need to do that, but all of a sudden I say, like, you know what, I just spent an hour reading this book and I haven't said any prayers today, right? So don't forget about our fundamentals. Don't get caught up in scheme. All right, so we talked about being coachable, committed, mentally tough, and being committed to fundamentals. Next thing I want to talk about is consistency. All right, when I'm watching a quarterback, I want to see how consistency plays. I don't need him to be good sometimes. I don't need him to be good once in a while. I need him to be good all the time. And so one thing I like to do is I like to find as many fourth quarter, two-minute drives as I can on a quarterback, okay? Because that's when the pressure is really on. Hey, I've got this offense. I need to drive this ball down and score. If we score, we win. If we don't score, we lose, right? Not a more pressure situation than that. Now, there are some guys, you're watching him, man, he throws the ball well. He's completing it. He's finding the open receiver. I like him. And all of a sudden, he gets in that pressure situation, and he gets nervous, and his muscles tighten up, and all of a sudden, he's not throwing it like he should. He's grounding the ball a little bit. And when the pressure comes on, he doesn't play as well. You got a couple guys, it's a little bit, doesn't happen as often. You get a few guys that you're watching, you're like, this guy's not very good. I don't like him. He's not making plays. And all of a sudden, two-minute situation, and he gets on fire, and he goes down and scores. And you're like, hey, where was that the rest of the game, buddy, all right? We don't need to save that till the fourth quarter. And then what we really want is we want a guy that looks good, and then when the pressure's on, he remains good, all right? Now, most of the best ones, you know, the Breezes and the Bradys and the Mannings, you might see their game tick up just a notch when the pressure comes on. I'm convinced, being with Drew for a few years now, that the more pressure there is, his heartbeat slows down, the game slows down. He becomes just a little bit better as everyone else is getting more tense. All right, and that's okay. I'll take that. But I just don't want to see a guy that either folds when the pressure's on or if all of a sudden that's what it takes for him to perform. So we're looking for consistency. And it's important for us to be consistent. All right, I think so often our lives can get so busy. You know, in this 21st century, you know, there's so much going on that we can kind of get distracted from what's important. We can let things slide. Busyness gets in the way. And, you know, you heard Patrick Madrid talk about it a little bit. I think sometimes, I know that I've gotten in this, hey, God, I'm not rejecting you, but I'll get to you later, all right? I'll give you time when I have time. I don't have it right now, all right? And you feel like, hey, I got some time. I'll be able to make this up. Well, unfortunately, we don't have a scoreboard up in our lives. We might be able to get away with that if we could look up and say, all right, I still got 10 minutes left. I'm only down by 2 sins. I'm going to be good. We don't know when our time is coming, okay? We don't know. And there is no scoreboard to tell us where we're at. So don't put off being your best self. You know, John Wooden, one of the greatest basketball coaches of all time, he said, make every day your masterpiece. All right, so don't let the world distract you. Every day, be your best self. Don't put it off. You know, there was a movie made recently called Act of Valor. I don't know if any of you have seen it, but it's a movie with real Navy SEALs in it, and it's basically this, them going off and kicking butt. It's pretty cool. And one of the Navy SEALs in this movie, he writes a letter to his newborn son, and he gives it to a friend of his. He says, hey, if I don't make it out, I want you to deliver this to my son. And so, as the movie went, this guy didn't make it out. And so this letter went on. They were kind of reading it at the end of the movie. And there was a quote in there from an Indian chief named Tecumseh. And I'm sorry, I don't know a whole lot about him, but I did remember this quote. It said, so live your life that the fear of death can never enter your heart. I think that's a motivating message for us, okay? To know that we can stand before God and say, hey, listen, I know I wasn't perfect, but I promise you I gave you my best. All right, I didn't put you off. Every day, I tried to make you the most important thing. And I think that's an important challenge for us to take. So consistency. So we're coachable, we're committed, we're mentally tough, we got good fundamentals, and we're consistent. Last thing I want to talk about is leadership. All right, the quarterback needs to be a leader of your team. He needs to be the hardest worker. He needs to be the first one to show up in the morning and the last one to leave at night. Okay, so players need to look at him and say, hey, I know that he's doing everything he can to be the best he can be. All right, if players are looking, they see a quarterback cutting corners, it's not going to be good for the team. I promise you. They know that he's important. They need to hold themselves to a higher standard. All right, they need to work harder. They need to stay out after practice longer. And if you're lucky, you're going to have a vocal leader. All right, we're lucky in New Orleans. Drew is not afraid to speak up, encouraging the guys. All right, encourage them, get in your playbook, stay after practice, work harder. If you watch any of our games, you're going to see him before the game. He's in the middle doing the pregame chant. You know, he's getting them all fired up. So he's a vocal leader. And we're very fortunate because not everyone's comfortable doing that. Because when you stand up as a vocal leader, now you're kind of putting yourself out front. And it's risky because all of a sudden you throw a bad pass. Well, who's he to tell us? Look at him. He just made that bad pass. He's telling us to get in the playbook. He just made a mental error, right? You put yourself out there for criticism, and it's not comfortable. And you got to have some courage to do that. I promise you, I am not comfortable being up here talking about my faith. I've got very old school Catholic sensibilities, right? I like to go into a dark church and kind of be in the corner and pray, and I'd really prefer no one holding my hand during the Our Father, okay? And this whole notion of standing up and talking about my faith, and you know, when Father was up here earlier and he was saying amen, I was like, wait, we didn't say a prayer. What was that about? You know, it's just, this really isn't something I'm comfortable with, but I think it's important in today's day and age when you look out there in a world that continually seems to grow more morally upside down and harder to figure out, that those of us who believe what we believe, that we're willing to stand up and talk about it, all right, and be a witness about what we believe in, because the world needs more leaders. The world needs men to stand up and be strong, all right? So first off, for those of you who are fathers, all right, it's important that you be the leaders of your family. Let your kids see you hit your knees and pray, all right? Lead your family, and it doesn't have to be the rosary. I mean, I recommend it. I think it's great, but lead your family in some sort of prayer tradition where every day you're connecting on that level. And then I think, you know, Patrick Madrid up here, he was talking about learning about our faith and be able to talk about it persuasively. I think that's very important. You know, he gave a bunch of great examples that kind of shamed me, because I know that I was coaching a player who was a very strong Christian, a great guy, but he would come at me with some of these anti-Catholic, you know, points that Patrick was talking about. And some of them I could answer better than others, but probably my best line, which now I'm kind of ashamed of listening to him, was we're every night before a game, we've got a Catholic Mass, and we've got a Protestant chapel, right, non-denominational. So we're coming out of the Catholic Mass, and here comes this player, Mark, out of the Protestant chapel. I said, well, how was the JV meeting? He said, so what are you talking about? I said, well, I was just at the varsity meeting. I just want to know how the JV meeting was. So that probably wasn't very persuasive in pulling Mark towards the Catholic faith. But I think it's important that we can talk to either non-Catholics or you know, Catholic men that you just know aren't living the true richness of our Catholic faith. So that's another important factor about being a leader and holding yourself to a higher standard. You know, no excuses. Don't feel sorry for ourselves. You know, there's a story, and I apologize if you heard it. I always thought this was a common joke that everyone heard, but someone told it, a priest told it at Mass the other day, and it brought down the house, so I'm going to give it a try. There was this bar, and the regulars were all in there, and a new guy comes in, he sits down, he orders 3 beers. All right, so the bartender brings them to him, they watch, and this guy's drinking the beers one at a time. One sip, and he's just going through until they're all gone. And he orders 3 more. And the regulars are going, what's going on with this guy? You know, why does he order these 3 beers? I don't get it. So the bartender goes over and he says, hey, just curious, you know, I see that you ordered these 3 beers, just wondering, you know, why you're doing this. So the guy says in an Irish brogue, which I won't try to imitate, he says, oh, I've got two brothers, and we all left Ireland and went to different places, and we promised each other that whenever we went out and had a beer, that we'd order 3 beers all together in honor of each other. And the bartender said, well, that's really cool. That's awesome. All right. And told the regulars, and everyone thought that was a great tradition that this guy had going on. And so pretty soon this guy became a regular, and he'd come in, and the bartender would have his 3 beers ready, and he'd drink them. But one day this guy comes in, and he only orders 2 beers. And, you know, the bar kind of gets quiet, and they're saying, gosh, what do you think happened? You think one of his brothers died? Oh, my gosh, everyone's feeling terrible. So the bartender brings over the 2 beers. He says, hey, listen, these are on me. The guy says, oh, thank you, but why? He goes, well, you just ordered 2 beers. We just figured one of your brothers died. He goes, oh, no, I just gave up drinking for Lent. So he could have held himself to some higher standards, right? Could have challenged himself a little more. So once again, I just want to say thank you for inviting me to be out here. I hope you got something out of this talk, and I know I got a lot out of the other 2 speakers. But again, I think the whole theme of this day has been obviously to learn your faith, to love it, and to live it. And I think it's a great challenge to all of us to just take it seriously and be 100% committed. Thank you.